I'm in the fabulous surroundings, my favourite place in the world to come to, which is the reading rooms at the Wellcome Museum, the Wellcome Trust, on Euston Road in London. And it's always an inspirational place to come when you are interested in anatomy or medicine or science or anything like that. And the room behind me is the reading room, and then down here is the library. So if ever you're in London, it's free to come into, and there's a great cafe downstairs. Today I'm thinking about what is the most important joint of the body, and it kind of comes down to a few things depending on where you look at. Now in Vesalius, which is a book upstairs, and Vesalius is Fabrica Humanis Corpus Humanum, I always get it wrong, he talks about the most important bone, the most amazing joint in the body, being the first cervical vertebrae between the head and the skull and the neck, and this ability to be mobile, to move around on it. And I kind of get it, but for me, what we're looking at is the thing that is, from a biological evolutionary perspective, it's going to have to be the temporomandibular joint, this joint here, this ability for us to be able to use our mandible to open and close our mouth. Because if you think about it, although most communication is non-verbal, the face is the first thing we go to. That's the first thing. If we can't communicate visually with our eyes, with our ears, whatever you have, facial expression, then we're going to be finding it difficult. That's the first thing. But the big thing is this: if every single moment that you are swallowing, using your tongue, eating, drinking, is involving this joint, it's small movements, but without them, that's it, you're stuffed. So literally the potential to be alive is stemming from your ability to open this joint. We only started cooking our food, really, it's thought about 100,000 years ago, and before that it was all sort of fibrous and raw meat if we could get it. And since then we could cook our food, and we could get much more of a much more nutrition in a shorter space of time, so it was kind of a big deal for us. But certainly without the ability to be able to open and close our jaw, as far as eating and drinking is concerned, we will die. You know, now these days we can make some soup and we can sip on it, but you know, that wasn't an option so long ago. And so what's around here is this enormous ability, this incredible capacity for the fibres to be held in place between the mandible here and this temporalis in here. Now when you feel the temporalis, it doesn't really feel like there's much to it. It feels a bit thin, and you've got the skull underneath it, the temporal bone. But when you start to peel away the layers of connective tissue, it's unlike any other muscle that you'll ever find. So temporalis isn't, you know, if you look in the anatomy book, we'll put the picture of a temporalis up and you'll see it sort of looks like, you know, a muscle structure there. Peel away the fascia and there it is, and it's not how it works. So temporalis has this incredible overlay of fascia blending into muscle, blending into fascia, and then in amongst that you find these little layers of fat. And this is kind of important because muscle does need fat to have energy. You know, we think of fat as being around the body that we can burn, but also muscle contains fat that needs to be used as an energy source and also as a lubrication source. Now the temporalis tucks right in behind the eye here. So we see that the fibers of temporalis will also blend around and quite happily become the inside of the orbit of the eye and blend into the fascia of the orbicularis oculus. So temporalis, as it goes through, we have this zygomatic bone here. Temporalis goes through this zygomatic arch and it joins up with this big fella in here, and this is our masseter. And oh my goodness, you don't get bigger, stronger and harder working structures than you have in this cheek. You know, we've heard of ox cheeks and stuff like that, and that's really what we're doing. So we are working this bone, this muscle, all the time, swallowing, as I said, talking, eating, drinking. There is nothing we can't do without this masseter and this temporalis interacting and applying the pressure onto the joint, the TMJ. So TMJ, temporomandibular joint, there's more vector forces going in applying here when you're biting down than there is between your finger. If I bite my finger, so the load into this TMJ is absolutely enormous, and the connective tissues, the fascias, I'm going to say, that blend in and out and around, are massively continuous. the internal fascia of the temporalis, or the external, depending on you, both carry on and join this scalp fascia, the gallia aponeurotica, that sits across the top of the head. And then from there, we can see structures like sternocleidomastoid blending into that. So although Vesalius was very keen on the joint in terms of things like, you know, the first vertebral joint, the atlas, and the axis joints up in the neck being the most important joints, the most fantastic joints, and he was quite right in terms of our ability to move our head around. Without the ability to open and close our mouth, we wouldn't even be alive. So this joint is really huge. The implications anatomically for it, and physiologically for it, and also the presentations that we see are pretty big. So, you know, we will have things like, you know, the migraines and obviously trigeminal neuralgia, and pressures that we're going to see in and around this joint are phenomenal. The mandible is one of the few joints, I'm going to say one of the only joints really, that goes all the way from one side to the other. It you know, has a mental symphysis in the middle of it, and I don't know why it's called mental, but it is. It has this mental symphysis in the middle of it and a couple of holes, but essentially it's a bone that goes all the way across. And it would only be, you know, something like the sacrum, which would be similar. And sacrum doesn't have anything like the degree of movement. And the strength and the load that's in here means that even the slightest amount of movement that you have, you know, one side or the other of the jaw, is going to affect shoulders, neck, breath, you name it. It's going to have huge knock-on implications wherever we happen to go. So it's a very, very big deal. Bring the head forward, bring the chin forward, bring in the position of the face in a slightly different way, even slightly the head, and as a result of this movement of the jaw being imbalanced is a big deal. So it's worth looking at. Back pain presentations you can easily link as far as TMJ stuff is concerned. Allergies, hay fever, you name it. There's so much in up and around here. Even, you know, down to things like you know, hip and thoracolumbar fascia are all going to be blended into here. The moment you move your jaw, you move your head with it. It's connected to the whole of the head. So very, very cool. I did a dissection on this area, which I filmed, and it is just the most phenomenal thing that you'll ever see. You know, as the temporalis heads down through the zygomatic arch, it's quite remarkable, fibers involved. So the most important joint in the body, temporomandibular joint, without any question. But you might have a different view and a different reason. So go right ahead, argue with me, and look at your own. Does it click? Does it crunch? Does it move around? Do other people's? Do you use it in your assessment? So put your comments in the comment section below, and please don't forget to like and subscribe and do all those things you're supposed to do on social media. And if you ever get the chance, if you're in London, pop along to the Wellcome Trust. There's always a good exhibition on downstairs as well. There's some great things happening down there, some really interesting exhibitions. They had one on magic not so long ago. And get along to the Wellcome Trust on Euston Road, have a little look. And I will see you next time. See how quiet I'm being today? It's remarkable, isn't it?